Awesome, thanks, Greg. And we do love boring databases, just to start with. I'm Venkat Sivasubramanian. I lead the data and the analytics group for the Predix's GE's industrial IoT platform, Predix. And I have...
I am Arvind. I work for Venkat in his group.
That's awesome. So together, we're going to talk about how we deal with time series data for the industrial IoT world, the challenges that we face, the alternative storage that we considered recently, specifically Scylla, and the migration strategy we employed. Okay, so this might be a slightly outdated slide, but let's roll with a quick survey. It's just a show of hands. How many of you guys have a GE appliance or a bulb in your home? Okay, yeah, that's good. How many of you guys know that GE does more than these? Okay, that's a fair share. Thank you for the honesty. So how many of you guys know about GE's Predix platform, the IoT platform? Okay. For those who don't know, it's an industrial IoT platform that makes it easy to build IoT applications, specifically focused on various industries that we're going to touch upon. Anyone that's aware of Predix's time series offering here? Okay, a few hands. So that's a purpose-built data store for storing sensor data for machines. We're going to talk about it more today. And before we dive in, a few facts about GE. So they say every 2 seconds there is an aircraft that is taking off somewhere in the world that's carrying a GE jet engine. So 25% of world's power are basically generated by GE's engines. Last one 80% is... 80% of North America, this is an extra one, 80% of North America's power are generated by GE machines. I mean, that's specifically North America alone. Some of the wind turbines that we essentially manufacture are like half the height of Empire State Building. So these are massive machines that we're talking about. And if you guys have like more of these facts, I have one last one. I mean, we are hiring, if you don't know. So definitely meet us on the side, Arvind or I, to catch up on that. So like I said, GE is not just an appliance or a lighting company. GE Renewables manufactures some of the largest and most powerful wind turbines out there in the market. This is a halide turbine. That's the one that's like half the height of an Empire State Building. This one turbine can generate about 12 megawatts that can roughly power about 16,000 European homes. And because these are renewables, we have to build models and keep improving it to make sure there is no unplanned outages or downtimes. And use drones to essentially sort of capture the areas around this. An example is Alpine Battery. This is in Switzerland. GE team sort of helped use the excess energy that comes out of these renewables and then move the water to an elevated basin. So they essentially use this in the low periods of solars and winds to sort of turn them on. So they essentially use it as a dam to basically build energy. GE Power builds these massive sort of steam and gas turbines. This particular one is built in France, and this is essentially a world record pretty much for being the most efficient one. Each one of these could potentially power up to 500,000 homes. Our monitoring diagnostic center in Atlanta, where we manage a lot of these turbines remotely. This particular one manages about 1,500 turbines. Today and every day, we run about 900,000 to 1 million analytics on Predix to power this system. So that not only provides them with alerts and alarms on outages and services, but also give them efficiency controls and recommendations. So aviation, builds the state-of-the-art jet engines. So some of these engines, the largest engine was built by GE and it's being tested by Boeing. The Dreamliner uses the GE's jet engines. They say there are about 2,200 jet engines at any point in time in the air, carrying about 300 people approximately in each. So that's like about 660,000 people in the air at any point in time, pretty much. This particular team is also pushing the boundaries on 3D printing, specifically creating sort of very complex parts using additive, like fuel nozzles and fuel heaters. These parts are not only made easier to manufacture with additive, but also reduces the total number of pieces. For example, the fuel nozzles are like 12 pieces. The traditional ones, the 3D printing ones, are just one piece. And it also reduces the weight of these parts by like 30%, which is pretty huge in an aviation industry. Coming to Predix, Predix's ultimate focus is to sort of become the underpinning for all of these different sort of assets and use cases that we just talked about. It offers a set of tools and services to build IoT applications quickly. Two major focus of Predix. One is sort of give alerts and alarms for services or maintenance to improve the uptime of the asset itself. The other one is to also monitor for safety of people and environment and whatnot. Predix's data fabric is one of the important components of Predix, and that's the team that I lead. It offers a set of tools and set of services for ingesting at scale, from getting machine data from all over the places into the cloud. It offers a set of storage services, including very specific sort of industrial focused services like time series, and offers a set of analytical data processing services where people can essentially run their analytical workload. So just before diving into time series, I just wanted to basically give you guys some background. We do have several time series instances running in production that basically helps a bunch of these businesses that we talked about. Some of them are dedicated instances that we create. Some of them are shared instances. And when I mean shared, they are sometimes shared across smaller customers or sometimes shared across different kinds of workloads, so both of those. But along the way, we kind of actually figured out I'm going to basically go to the next slide and come back to this one. We figured out a bunch of challenges in the way we essentially do time series today. We do use Cassandra. As you guys are probably aware, there is actually a node level limitation on Cassandra on how much data you could store on a specific node. The usual recommendation is about a 2 terabyte. If it's a 2 terabyte and we're talking about, let's say, a 150 terabyte database or a 300 terabyte database, it's roughly like 150 individual nodes. And that's like a normal size for us when we essentially spin these instances. And when your node size goes at that level, what potentially happens is it increases a bunch of problems, pretty much. One is adding new nodes becomes more difficult because you are only adding smaller nodes, a 2 terabyte node. And each node addition into the cluster is usually sequential, and it actually takes about a day or two because the data has to reshuffle and then before we can add another node. Taking a node down is another problem where you have to essentially do a node tool repair on all of the other nodes to basically get the keys off of it. That's equally challenging. Because these clusters are pretty used pretty heavily, we normally hit the latency numbers pretty quickly. And because the previous set problems are on increasing and decreasing our problem, SLAs are always on the edge pretty much. The last one is about talent pool. I mean, you guys should completely be aware of this problem as well. It is increasingly harder to basically find talent with like niche skills, and especially when you have to go run these clusters in so many places, it becomes a harder problem. Okay, so off to like why we start. That's off to why we started looking for an alternative storage. So some of the requirements that we had in order to essentially pick up one is to essentially be able to sustain a workload of about a terabyte per day, which is a sustained load. We've essentially definitely seen a double of it in like one cluster we're talking about here. And then observe about 10 billion, tens of billions of data points. I mean, these are sensor data that is coming in. And when these data are getting ingested, they don't just get ingested as raw data, but there is a lot of aggregations and roll-up that happens parallelly as well. We do have a lot of analytics, like we talked about in use cases, that have to run in parallel. So there are about 1 million analytics that we see in some of the use cases that we wanted this database to essentially support. And these 1 million analytics normally translates to tens of queries in pretty much each. So the amount of queries essentially go increasingly high. The last but not the least is sub-second latency is very important. It's one of those times where you say every second counts. It really counts because you're essentially monitoring reactors and oil rigs in the middle of the sea. So there are thermal pressures that we have to manage and measure. And some of these systems are live in production, so we can't essentially take delay for an answer pretty much. So it has to be sub-second all the way from ingestion to query. I'm going to now roll this off to Aravind to talk about evaluations. Thank you.
Okay. Yeah, so region we started considering Scylla. Number one, because the website claimed that they have 10x performance compared to Cassandra, and who doesn't want that? Because one of our focus, in addition to performance, low latency, is also cost. Because we have customers, and they have their own customers, that how they are making money. So more the infra and more the infra cost, lower their profit. So they want us to reduce the number of nodes that they need. So that's why we started looking at Scylla. And the second motivation was that we are migrating to the new data model. And with the new data model, new cluster, we needed to migrate the data. So we tried it with Cassandra. We tried with various sizes of clusters. We will always get timeout. We tried a lot of tuning. We talked with support also. We tried different size of cluster. But we could never get the Spark code to run reliably like for days. And we tried it both with migration, with rollup. In both cases, we got the same problem. And that's when basically we contacted Scylla, and Scylla guys basically came over. They gave us AMI, we installed the AMI, and support like YAL, Glober, they were always available to support us, and that's how we started. Yeah, so this is talking about the time series data model. So basically, the timestamp is one of the key components in our data model. And we divide timestamp into days, days into hours, and then basically offset within hour, and that's how we store the data. That's how we ingest the data, that's how we query the data. And we have rollup also, and rollup was the one case where basically Cassandra was not able to handle it because we are using a Spark with multiple containers running in parallel, and we're always getting timeouts. And this is talking about one of the clusters that we have today, and this is, we are using it for our client. Our clients are running their own test on it, and this is basically an analytics that runs in excess of, tens of millions of queries a day. And each of these queries are very heavy, so you can consider each of them like 50 different queries because they are trying to query 50 different sensors in one query. And in this case, we are using 9 nodes, ScyllaDB cluster, which is i3 8x large. And these are different components. You have like time series nodes. You have that is time series query service. That is our Java application that is serving the REST endpoint. And you have Kafka and Zookeeper that is ingesting the data and keeping it for a few days. And you have the pipeline that does the processing, error checking, and ultimately transforms the payload into the time series data. And these are some of the performance numbers that we see on this 9 node clusters. So this is 2.5 billion data points per hour of ingestion. And when you're talking about 2.5 billion data points, actually we have 4 tables. So we are populating 4 different tables. Not all of them are getting populated in each query, but in many cases they are. So you can say that actual table write will be like twice or higher than this one. And this translates to 700K data points per second. And this is talking about the query performance. And this is the number of data points, which is our unit You can consider it a database record pretty much. And this is 325 million data points read per hour, which translates to 90K data points read per second. And again, this is like an unit, but again, we are going through multiple tables. And not necessarily like we are firing 90K individual Scylla queries. Some of the queries are large, so they are trying to fetch like thousands of records or hundreds of records in one. And in some cases, they are pretty small. We are reading only one data point. So this doesn't translate exactly to the number of Scylla queries, but this is how many data points we are reading. And these are some of the requirements we had when migrating. Because it's a production cluster with thousands of customers and millions of sensors sending data concurrently and millions of analytics running with different size of the load, some only looking for the last hour of data and some looking for like last year worth of data, because that is the data they're using to train their models. And so we have to continue that while we read from the cluster and migrate the data into the new cluster. And as you see in the slide here, so if you can reduce the number of nodes from 150 to say like 15 or 20, that does reduce our operational overhead quite a bit. So that was one of the focus in addition to improving performance. And this is talking about the migration strategy that we took. So we took Spark. Spark is what is hosting our migration code. And Scylla is able to basically do some transformation while we are transferring the data. So they can change the column names and they can do some basically whatever tuning that is required to be done. And this is just a picture of how you can shrink your cluster size. So Scylla does support denser, more powerful nodes with higher storage. So that does give you opportunity to have fewer nodes. Yeah, this is talking about the end result. So yes, definitely our cluster size is much smaller. Performance has been pretty good. We haven't tried to do like one-to-one comparison of Cassandra versus Scylla, but overall we are happy with the performance, and especially we are very happy with the support. Eyal is here, Glover is here. I mean, they provide terrific support over Slack. And I mean, Glover is ready to meet with me at 5:30 a.m. on Saturday. So yeah, that is really great. Yeah, this is talking about what we care about. We care about a scale. In one cluster, we have 300 terabyte of data already. And this is because we want to keep our cost low. Otherwise, we can have petabyte of data. We only hold data for 6 months. That's why the size is so small, only 300 terabyte. But if you are able to keep for 2 years, it will be like petabyte and more. And of course, it has to be stable because we have customers who have their customers, and SLA is very important. In some cases, data has to flow from oil rig, which is out in the sea, come to the cloud, go through our pipeline, go into Cassandra, then run through our query service, then they have to run the analytics and generate an alarm, and all of that should happen within a minute. So that SLA requirement is really big for us. Yeah, so that's about it, yeah. And we are here after the talk to answer any questions. Thanks.